like I mentioned, that everything in balance and in moderation is correct. Where it veers off that middle balanced equilibrium, it starts to create and become a problem. Now, some types of modesty are actually blameworthy rather than praiseworthy. And today, very briefly, we will look at what is termed as blameworthy modesty. So, modesty in Arabic, we say haya, and haya, like I mentioned, is very, very integral in deen. Which type of modesty, the Imam here mentions, that type of modesty that prevents one. So that type of modesty is blameworthy, which prevents one from doing a few things. When there is an opportunity, and when there is a need to denounce tyranny, corruption, something that is wrong, and then we say, oh, I've got too much haya and I won't do that, that is that blameworthy modesty. And that is not obviously something we should be doing in Islam. So modesty in itself, again, is fine, but where it stops us from denouncing something that needs to be denounced, something that is wrong, then obviously this sort of modesty is not praiseworthy, but rather blameworthy. So the Imam has mentioned here two things, for example, tyranny and corruption, and like that you can extrapolate and extend to many, many other things that have been mentioned. Remember, something that is condemnable, something that is a munkar, in Sharia we say munkar, is condemnable, regardless of the status of the person who is engaged in it. And this is very important, because the Imam is drawing my attention and your attention, that when we go about and we want to do, for example, amr bil ma'ruf, nahi anil munkar, call people towards that is good, encourage them, and discourage them from bad, then the status of the person is of no consequence. So we will carry on with doing it, whether it's somebody who is close to us or somebody who is far from us. So if it is our own family, it is very double standards that if something happens in my family, then I won't say this is against Sharia, why am I doing it, why are you doing it? And if it is happening in somebody else's family, or it is very easy to stand on the minbar and condemn everybody else but oneself and one's own actions, that is very wrong. So the Imam is mentioning a very important point with regard to modesty, and this is what is he terms as blameworthy modesty. And another reason why modesty should not be a barrier is in seeking knowledge. When a person has a genuine question and a genuine desire to know something, then that person must ask. Then there is no modesty. And the person should not feel shy of asking. Because if a person does not ask, then what is the option? To remain ignorant for the rest of a person's life? That's not a good option. Like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's wife, Aisha radiallahu anha, she narrated this, that the best women were the women of the Ansar. Why? Because modesty did not prevent them from learning the religion. And then Aisha radiallahu anha mentions this, an incident where one of the women of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's time, she came and she asked a very very personal question to women with regards to menstruation, a very personal question. And she insisted on asking, so much so that the Prophet started to become shy. The Prophet himself started to become shy and then said, go to Aisha. Aisha, you show her what it actually means and what it actually is. But that's why they were praised. So if there is a need to ask a question, then by all means, it should be driven by a sincere motive. By all means, the person should always ask. Modesty should not then be a barrier for a person asking questions. So to summarize, modesty is always a good quality, except when it stops us from condemning something that needs to be condemned, or when it prevents us from learning something we should really be learning or aspiring to know more about. But remember, this is not a license now to start a channel of condemnation. And it's not a license for us now to condemn every person and everybody. we should not be swift at condemning people. Remember that. Why? Because this creates another disease. When now any person does anything wrong, we consider ourselves as a haram police. Everything haram, haram, bid'ah, haram, haram, everything, everything and anything, that is not conducive. This then breeds another disease, which is self-righteousness, that holier than thou attitude, and that again is wrong. So we need to strike a balance where genuinely we think something is wrong, something needs to be done about it, then do not hold back. A person should do something about it, but always acting in the interest of Allah's deen. It is for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not interest of myself or whatever else may be of motivating me to do or say what I am doing or saying. So anyway, this is very briefly something with regard to modesty. Are there any questions? Anybody has anything that needs to be clarified, ambiguous with regard to this point? Okay, if there's nothing else, inshallah, we will carry on with the next trait. Conscious of time. So. Okay, this is the next spiritual malady. And this is something that at this age in our life is very, very common. Very, very common. And that is fantasizing. So what is fantasizing? And what are the limits with regard to it? Inshallah, we will explore. So this is, first of all, obviously the poem verses. Now what is fantasizing? Everyone knows, everyone is well aware with regard to it. Now which type of fantasizing is haram and how do we go about it? The first and foremost is lustful fantasizing. This is a disease of the heart. And if we do not check this disease and do not remedy this disease, this carries on. And Allah forbid, I mean, you know, even if a person marries, gets married, Allah forbid, and he's, you know, with the spouse, husband or wife, whatever it is, and a person did not look after himself when he himself or herself when they were younger, then it becomes a problem in that person's marriage. And trust me, I'm speaking out of the experience I have with people who have had this problem. And it carries on. So from now, we should be very firm on ourselves. The mind starts to wander. We need to rein. We need to rein our mental, you know, our mind from wandering. And not increase it and, you know, have any sort of visual or audio aids to increase this sort of fantasy. This is totally forbidden, and this will only lead, trust me, my dear young friends, this will only lead to a ruined life. Honestly, it is nothing but a ruined life. So remember, this is the essence of what it means when we say fantasize. Whatever is forbidden to do is likewise forbidden to fantasize about. Okay? So this is basically what it is. Now, okay, let's carry on. Thinking about the weakness or faults of others, whether they are present or not, is also part of this sort of disease. So when we're always constantly thinking and wishful thinking and fantasizing about how this person may or this person's fault, which may be or may not be reality, this is also part of this disease. And this is a disease that we really need to look into ourselves and try to rid if there is this disease within us. The Prophet of Allah has said very, very beautifully that there is a tree in Jannah reserved for one whose own faults preoccupied him or her from considering the faults of another. This is a beautiful hadith. That there is a tree into paradise. So basically, a person can only get a tree in paradise if a person actually enters paradise. So what the Prophet of Allah is actually saying that entry into Jannah can be guaranteed by this one thing. Just this one thing. Huh? That when a person is preoccupied by his or her own faults, this hinders the person's desire to worry about somebody else's faults. So this is very interesting. Somebody has said very beautifully, we have two eyes. One eye is to look at the good of others. And the second eye is to look at my faults. So use it in that way, inshallah. So this is, anyway, this is one of the traits that we need to rid ourselves of, that the Imam has pointed out. Any questions with regard to this? The cure for this, the Imam actually hasn't actually mentioned it in this, but the cure, obviously, like I indicated, is a person for fantasizing is just simple, try not to. Rein oneself, control oneself, self-restraint. You know? Because fantasizing is conjuring up images and using a person's vivid imagination that Allah has given him or her, and using that, you know, for a destructive purpose. So obviously the cure for that would be, is that, first of all, don't put yourself in a position where you are more likely or not creating yourself those images that later on you go back and start to fantasize about. In other words, control a person's input. See, we fantasize about things. Where do we get the information from? Where? From these two channels. One is our eyes, and the other is our ears. So if we control these two, we are very careful where we place these two channels of information, and our sourcing of information is very controlled, then inshallah we won't create any objects we won't give fodder to the brain to start, you know, thinking and going more into detail about it. So inshallah, control of the audio-visual faculties that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. And that's why we see in Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the first thing, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ. Lower your gaze. قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ. Lower your gaze. So if we lower our gaze, you know, this is the first step, inshallah, of killing off the very first, you know, that we're not even opening the door for fantasizing to take root. So inshallah, this is the first thing, to control our audio and visual faculties that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. And slowly but surely, one person, you know, mentioned that if a person is constantly plagued, and this can become a disease, you know, a person is constantly plagued by this, and this is the only thing that the person starts to think of, and there's nothing else, there's nothing else that a person can think of, and almost it's gone beyond that person's control, then that person really needs to, number one, first of all, acknowledge that a person has a problem. Until a person does not accept he or she has a problem, there is no hope. Until a person does not acknowledge the person has a problem, there is no hope the person will find a solution. And remember, when we acknowledge it and identify it, this is the first step towards reformation. Because a problem identified is almost half solved. So identify that a person has a problem, and secondly, identify the sources of help a person can consult to try to remedy the problem. And this is the general principle for all these things that we have discussed, if a person feels. Are there any other questions with regard to the previous, what we talked about? Okay. Should we go on to the next one, Shabbat, or what do you think? Should we go on to the next one? Because it's a bit longer.
Should we break for Salah?
Or we can break for Salah and carry on to the next one. What do? Shall we do that? The next part is, the next section is with regard to fear of poverty. The Imam has termed it as fear of poverty. This is something that is definitely a concern to each and every human being. And it is natural for a person to fear about the unknown, about what will a person do, how will a person feed and clothe himself and his family or herself and her family, etc., etc. So this is a real fear that within each and every one of us. Now what we are tasked to do is to keep that natural fear within parameters of reason, and not to make it the overriding and all-controlling fear that overtakes us at each and every time. So how do we do this? We have to realize a few points. The first is, this fear, where does it originate from? Very interestingly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said in Quran that in the ash-shaytan ya'idukumul faqr. Shaytan threatens you with poverty. In the shaytan, ash-shaytan ya'idukumul faqra wa ya'murukum bil fahsha. And he commands you to immorality. And it's amazing how these two have been linked together in Quran. Poverty, immorality. We'll explore that a bit more. But on the other hand is Allah's promise. So the promise or the threat of shaitan on one hand is counterbalanced by the promise of Allah for forgiveness and bounty. Allah ya'idukum maghfiratan minhu wa fadla. Fadla is all types of bounties and blessings. So these two conflicting emotions are stirred up. And this is, on one hand is shaitan, and the other hand is the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So to understand it, and when that fear for poverty comes about, then more or less that irrational fear is definitely from shaitan. So this is part of shaitan's handiwork, this is part of his tactics, and he has put it very beautifully, that this is the tactics to keep people so occupied with the fear. This fear is so overtaking people that they end up desperately, to the extent that there is desperation about keeping hold of the money that a person has. And this will obviously then deprive them of doing good deeds, like giving to the needy, and all other goodnesses that are associated with spending to those who are in need. So remember that this is a tactic from shaitan. And this is how shaitan puts about this irrational fear. And this can take different forms. Just the other time, you know, somebody came to me and was mentioning, Imam, I think I'm going to lose my job. I think I'm going to lose my job. I said, why? Has the boss said anything about it? No. Is there any sort of indication that you're going to lose your job? No. Why? Why are you so fearful? Are there cutbacks? Maybe the council or wherever you are working, you know, they're thinking about cutbacks, and this is a time of, what do they call it? Time of cutbacks and drawbacks and all these different things. Is that why? No. So then why? Why this this fear? And it's overtaking. It was overtaking, literally overtaking her life. Oh, because of that, she was starting to get problems with her marriage, with that, problems with her children. Why? I just feel I'm going to lose my job. Have you done anything wrong? No, I haven't. Are you working to what you're supposed to do? Yes, I am. But this fear, and this is the way it comes from shaitan. And this is where shaitan threatens you. And because of that, then it opens a whole host of sins. A person starts to fear, and because of that, a person will do this, that, and the other, just trying to assure and ensure oneself from this irrational fear. So this is how shaitan, and if it takes root, it's very, very difficult. And a person, and the cure will come, inshallah, and we will discuss it more, a little bit more about how to do it. So when a person becomes under this sort of a spell, it's like a spell of irrational fear, then a person becomes very vulnerable to transgress the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why you can see Allah talks about poverty and immorality. And when a person fears poverty, then this comes to the point where a person indulges in lewdness. And there's a very interesting study to show why people take part in this immoral lifestyle. And one of the main reasons is poverty, fear of poverty. And this is what Allah has mentioned in Quran. So this becomes a real fear. But remember, with all irrational fears, it becomes like a phobia. And you can't understand why it takes such a great root within oneself. And How do we go about treating this? So before that, there's a very important point that the Imam makes mention to, and this is mudahana. Mudahana is a Quranic term, and this is, what does it mean? Compromising a person's religion in order to achieve some sort of worldly gain. And this is often out of the fear of poverty or sheer greediness. Now, this is a very important concept that the Imam has put in with regard to fear of poverty. Because mudahana is very rife amongst those who are apparently pious. So using the garb of piety to gain dunya, that is mudahana. And this is where. So it's, and to the ulama, I've mentioned that this is even worse than a person who actually, you know, does what is apparently a means of getting a material gain. So if someone wants some sort of material gain, a person follows the method of accruing that material gain. So everybody will say, okay, if it's wrong, but that's actually the way of how we go about doing it. What's even worse than that is a person trying to accrue material gain through the guise of deen, through the guise of deen. So where a person apparently tries to show himself or herself as very deeny, and using the sort of fame a person gets because of portraying himself or herself as very pious to get something of this dunya. That is what is called mudahana, and that is where a person starts to compromise it. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is something, especially, we have to be very careful. Allah mentions in the Quran that they, in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they wanted the Prophet to become mudahin, meaning a person who will be compromised, who will bring about compromises in deen with the kuffar of that time. So it's very, very important, especially with da'wah. This is an important point, is that how far do we become? How far do we go? Are there limits in trying to get, for example, somebody we think is interested in deen? How far would we go in bending the rules of Sharia, trying to get that person into deen? You know, how far do the means justify the end? You know, this is an interesting concept, especially amongst our time today, and we have to think about it very deeply. That yes, ultimately we want people to become, for example, we want people to become closer to deen. But how far do we get to go? You know, how far will we bend the rules of Sharia and even break the rules of Sharia, trying to get somebody to uphold one aspect of deen or something? If you know what I'm trying to go towards, and this is what is mudahana. And the catch word is compromise. How far do we go compromising our values, our ideals, our beliefs, for whatever reason it might be? This is a very interesting quote. One of the poets has mentioned that what is mudahana, and he hits the nail on the head when he says, we mend our livelihood with the cloth of our religion. In the end, nothing of the religion remains, and our worldly condition does not goes unmended. So what he is saying, that we try to compromise, and one of the reasons of trying to compromise our deen is to get dunya. But at the end of it, we neither get the deen nor do we get the dunya. So we lose both ways, and this is what is the fear of a person who becomes extremely diluted and is willing at the drop of a hat to compromise our very fundamentals of deen. And then what happens to that person at the end of it? The person neither gets the dunya for which he was trying to achieve, nor is he left with deen. So this is very, 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 very pertinent to our times. And another way that it shows itself is when there is a conspiracy of silence. Everybody is conspiring not to say things. And people are turning a blind eye to when there is blatant wrongdoings that are going about, and nobody is talking about and everybody is just silent about it. This is mudahana, and this is something that is against the principles of fairness, equity, and justice that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants within our deen. So anyway, this is a part of a point of the original point of fear of poverty. Anyway, is there any questions so far with regard to this? Is anybody clear with regard to it? Any clarifications? Okay. Yes.
With the last point that you made, does that mean that, like you're saying, that we've got a social responsibility to talk about the injustices that are going on in different countries? Or do you think that that's not? Because people have different opinions on that, whether that's, like, say, for example, in Syria or Egypt, is that our responsibility to talk about it, or do we do it?
With regard to, Nabi of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam has said, and this is very, very clear in Quran, that each and every Muslim's troubles, each and every Muslim's problems, wherever they are, they may be in the world, he has likened it to a body, one body. So whenever there is any sort of difficulty in one part of the body, the rest of the part of the body becomes agitated. The rest of the part of the body wants to play a role in trying to alleviate that problem. And it is our right. It is our right. And it is our duty to try and help any person who is in need. It can be Muslims suffering in Syria, or non-Muslims suffering wherever they may be. It is just that humanity that we need to, like you mentioned, our social responsibility, that we need to, of course, we need to uphold. And there is no law, there is no reason why a person must talk about it. Least of all in the university. In the university, if there is no freedom to debate and no freedom to talk about what you agree or disagree, then where else can it be? But what is necessary? What is necessary to remember that each and every person is entitled to his or her opinion with regard to whatever is happening, but within reason. Within reason meaning a person now does not take the law in his or her own hands. That is totally irresponsible, that is not acceptable at all. So where a person wants to talk about it, wants to raise awareness with regard to it, there is no harm at all. But in a way that is obviously will not compromise a person's religion and also the law of the country. Because to follow the law of any country is also, because we have come here, for example, the ulama give the example that whichever country a person decides to settle in, and that's a conscious decision of that person. And part of that contract is that that person will abide to the laws of the country. And thereafter, if a person goes there, then a person cannot willfully transgress the laws of that country. Therefore, within the laws of the country, whatever a person wants to do with regard to it, then a person has obviously the social responsibility, and the person has also the freedom to do so. That's absolutely without. So for example, Syria, I mean, it's terrible what's happening there. And a person should do whatever humanitarian aid a person that I'm sure a lot of you will have done. Also like in the hospital, many people have also, you know, given aid, etc., that a person needs to give to our brothers and sisters that are terribly suffering in Syria. And of course, not forgetting dua. I mean, for us, dua is the greatest weapon that we can use. So dua, with that also whatever physically we can do with regard to it. And with regard to any situation. And this is one thing I would like to point, in my experience, this is just my experience, that alhamdulillah, definitely we have a social responsibility to every Muslim. And we should feel the pain the ummah is feeling. But remember, the ummah of Nabi of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam are not only Muslims. The ummah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, according to himself, is everyone who will come after the Prophet until the day of Qiyamah. And I think it would be very good that, mashallah, to raise awareness about issues in Syria, in Palestine, in Egypt, or wherever else it may be. But also, time to time, I would urge, you know, yourselves as young Muslims to show support for and you do, not that you don't, but to show more, even more support for other humanitarian causes where non-Muslims are involved. So because, you see, we have to be careful, and careful is that when we go about doing anything because of the media and the way we have to be media-wise, the media may portray it in a very negative way, the way we're doing things, and so therefore it's better that we try to help those who are, of course, Muslim, and even those who are non-Muslim, because our social responsibility is to all, each and every of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's creation. Nabi of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, I said very beautifully that the best of you is the one who benefits mankind the most. And here he has no restriction on whether they are Muslim or non-Muslim. Okay, are there any other questions with regard to this? Okay, let's carry on. With regard to the treatment of fear of poverty. Now this is a very real fear. And this is where a person's iman comes to the fore. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says very beautifully in Quran that وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهِ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا. If a person brings about taqwa, taqwa, roughly translated, is fear of Allah, can also be translated as the consciousness of Allah. If a person develops taqwa in his or her life, then Allah has promised, and this is the promise of Allah, that He will surely make a way from every situation the person is. يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا, a way out. And He will provide him, وَيَرْزُقُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ, for a place where the person never ever expected. And whoever trusts in Allah, Allah is sufficient for him. This is a most beautiful ayah. And try it, honestly try it. And this is not an ayah that is restricted for the extremely pious people, people who never sleep at night and always fasting. No, this ayah is true for each and every Muslim. And why I say this is because of experience. A person came to me and, you know, said, you know, I have this job. And this job wasn't a good Islamic job. You know, said, what should I do? Said, you know, carry on until you can find a better job, but make a conscious effort to get a better job. And see, alhamdulillah, that person went on, and this ayah shows that if we inculcate in ourselves this taqwa, then Allah will definitely provide. And the person provided. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, definitely Allah provided for him. Another person came and said, you know, Imam, this is how I am. I've got a job. And my job is that we have clients. You know, and we have to go out and search clients. And part of the sort of courting of the clients is we're given an allowance, and it's almost customary to offer them a drink, alcohol, wine, or whatever it is. You know, and this is part of it. And the company pays for everything like that. As a Muslim, what should I be doing? You know, I've obviously myself don't drink, but offering somebody a drink, I consciously can't do it. Now, the time has come for promotion. What should I do? You know, my manager has said, look, you have to do it. You know, if you really want to get into the job, and you're the best person for the job, but you have to make the sacrifice. What should I do? So I said, like Nabi of Allah, I said, that if your heart, whatever your heart is telling you that this is not something that I can do, and this is something that I should really do, you know, be honest with it and say to them. So he went and he said that, look, whatever you want to do at the end of the day is up to you, but I can't feel comfortable. I feel I'm compromising. I'm compromising my religious beliefs and values, therefore I cannot do it. And if you don't want to give me the promotion, that is your prerogative. And subhanAllah, and this is just not very long ago. And I say this because that same person came to me a few weeks and said, oh, the next day or a week later, the boss called me and said, okay, you got the promotion. What about that? Doesn't matter. Just carry on with the promotion. And wallah, this again and again and again. Simple. This ayah comes to the fore every time. But obviously, there has to be conviction. That a person is genuinely and sincere wants to do it. That's because Allah is the one who has the creation of the heavens and the earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who controls what is in the heavens and the earth. And remember, one other thing is that we should never harbor a bad thought, jealousy, envy, etc., for somebody who has more than us. That would be very counterproductive to our getting what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala what we want from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Similarly, this is a beautiful hadith of Allah alayhi wa sallam, and this is contentment. Fear of poverty for a person who has so much, this is an irrational fear. And this fear for poverty even comes to those who are very senior level. Go to a company. From the very people who are the domestic cleaners, who are fearing their job loss, and go to the CEO of the company and he has the exact same fears. And trust me, this is how it is. The very highest senior level managers also have fear for their jobs and fear of paying this, that and the other. And those who are at the very lowest level also have the very same fear, because this fear never stops. The only thing that a person that will stop this fear is what Nabi of Allah has said, contentment. Be content with your lot. Whatever Allah has given you, I am content. Alhamdulillah. Contentment is an amazing treasure. It's an amazing treasure. From now, if we can bring it into our lives, this will help us throughout our life, definitely. And this is something Mark Twain once remarked, that most of my problems I never actually encountered. This is very interesting, because it's true. We have 1,000 fears, but in our life, even if we have 1,000 years life, still we won't. Each and every one of these fears will not materialize. So our whole life goes about chasing shadows, really. Okay, anyway, that was the last, inshallah. I think it's time almost. Yeah, for this. Are there any questions with regard to this? We have a few minutes, I think, before the person comes to close the, with regard to fear of poverty. Any questions from this side? Any of the sisters? Jeff?
What do you mean by poverty? Like, in what sense is poverty?
Anything. A person fears, you know, loss of wealth. A person fears with regard to livelihood. You know, so it could mean for us not getting a job. It could be not getting, you know, a degree that might lead us to a job. Whatever it is, whatever source of income, loss of income, basically. You can translate it as that. So this is fear of poverty. Are there any other questions? Yes.
Is it just fear of poverty, or does it branch out to other stuff, just fear in general? Because people fear a lot of things.
As in this specific case?
Yeah, like...
I mean, yeah, there are many, many other fears that Imam has discussed to you previously also, and will discuss in the future, but particularly with regard to this fear of poverty, and fear of income, this is something that is very real, and this is what is mentioned here. But they are obviously, it branches out everywhere, because most of these are intertwined. So it will obviously branch out, exactly. Is that what you're asking us?
Yeah.
Okay, any other questions?
In terms of blameworthy modesty, is there any other examples apart from like your fear of question and like fear of like doing things that you're... Is there any other example apart from that?
I suppose, again, modesty that stops us. The general rule would be any modesty that stops us from gaining something that is beneficial, like knowledge, gaining something that is beneficial, like good acts, etc. Or anything that stops us and we think that the reason for it is modesty, then that would be considered as blameworthy modesty. So like we just mentioned, learning. When you want to learn, you need to ask the questions. And shyness should not stop you. Similarly, shyness should not stop you from doing things like, like it was mentioned, condemning, etc. Okay, so it's basically the principle behind it. Okay. Any other questions? Any other questions?
Buddha, you said that it's compromise on fundamentals of Islam. What can we compromise on? Like, can we compromise on sunnah or recommended things, for example?
Mudahana, compromising. Right, of course, a person, see, we are tasked to follow Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's deen as best as we can. And compromise is not a word we generally use for anything, really. whether it is something that is wajib, everybody understands that, even for sunnah, even for something that is because why should we compromise? You know, is there a need to compromise, and what would that mean? You know, compromising what for what? Yeah. If there is, what we can say, if there is a choice of the lesser of the two evils, etc., you know, then that is a separate thing. But compromise for the sake, especially like you mentioned, the compromising something of deen with the reason of getting dunya, that is what is actually mudah. Okay. Is there any other question, brother? Yeah.
Sorry. We talk about modesty. In regards to how can you prevent yourself from where you're trying to be modest, but you don't want to go cross the fine line of going to riya. So where you know you're trying to be modest, but some people be modest, but just to show that they are modest, but they're not really. So it's like it becomes a form of riya. How do you prevent that? Because shaitan's always attacking you as well, saying, you know, oh, you're a good person, etc. Stay humble for other people who think you are humble.
MashaAllah, that is very good, because the next thing is about riya. Come next week, inshallah. But that's a very good question.
Yeah.
But basically, in summary, is that whatever we do, whether we are being modest or whatever we do, the motivation behind it should be only, solely, wholly, exclusively, and totally for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we are outwardly showing we are ourselves to be modest, it's a very good question. Outwardly we show ourselves to have a lot of haya, and it's done for something else besides Allah, then that is riya. And how to safeguard oneself from riya, this is inshallah, quite a lengthy topic. But the main thing is to always check a person's motivation, intention. Why am I doing it? Before doing it, while doing that action, after doing that action, why did I do it? Why am I doing it? Who did I do it to please, etc. Being always scrutinizing one's actions. That's the best way of trying to check this disease of it. Anyway, Jazakumullah khairan for listening, and inshallah we will turn on next week.